When I first drove Volvo's new XC40, I have to say that I was definitely impressed. And then when we got this at home for our first full review of the XC40, I declared it quite simply the best small luxury crossover available in America. But since then, other manufacturers haven't been resting on their laurels because this is an incredibly hot and competitive segment in America. It's also a segment that has changed considerably over the last 5 years or so, because BMW used to offer a rear-wheel drive entry in the segment, and they don't anymore, putting the Volvo XC40 and the BMW X1 and even the X2 on relatively equal footing. Back then, the Volvo was the faster option in this segment, but recently BMW said, "Hey, hold my beer," and they've released an M-Performance version of their subcompact crossover. We also have the all-new Cadillac XT4, Jaguar E-Pace, the new Range Rover Evoque, a new Audi Q3, the Lexus UX, available with or without the hybrid system, and we also have a new Mercedes-Benz GLA coming very soon, and a Buick Encore if you want to look at something that's a little bit less expensive than this Volvo. So with all of these new options out there, is the XC40 still the best entry in this segment? Although this certainly looks like a member of the Volvo family, the XC40 shares relatively little with the larger Volvo crossovers, the XC60 and the XC90. Volvo designed an entirely new small car platform for the XC40 and several other upcoming models that we may or may not get in America. In terms of overall design, I have to say that I think the XC40 is one of the most attractive entries in this segment. It doesn't look boring, but it also avoids looking too cartoonish like some of the other options in this segment can. For instance, I think the Lexus UX just looks a little bit funny from some angles, whereas the BMW X1 looks a little bit too reserved, a little bit perhaps boring, some might say. I think the Range Rover Evoque and this XC40 are the two most attractive entries right now in this small crossover group. As we see in most of the new competition, we have full LED headlamps up front with some distinctive daytime running lamp strips right there. We also have a Volvo logo right there that hides the 360-degree camera and a slightly different grille look than we get in some of the rest of the Volvo lineup. From the side, you can see that Volvo really maintained that long hood proportion that we see in every other modern Volvo. But at 174.2 inches long, this is significantly shorter than the XC60 or the XC90. This is right about the same length overall as the Infiniti QX30, which has a very different overall design. As you can see, Volvo has gone very boxy, which is something that I appreciate, because if you're going to make a vehicle really short overall in terms of length, making it boxy and square in the rear is really going to help your overall cargo practicality, and we definitely see that in this and the BMW X1 as well. This is about 2 inches longer than the current generation Range Rover Evoque, and about 7 inches shorter than the Cadillac XT4. The XT4 is a little bit of an odd duck in this segment because it is notably longer than most of the competition outside, even though on the inside it ends up being very similar in terms of overall interior space. Moving to the rear, we find the familiar strong shoulder design that we see in other modern Volvos with these large LED tail lamps, and we have amber turn signals back here. This is the only Volvo sold in North America with amber turn signals. Why that is, I don't exactly know. Volvo tells us that the red turn signals we see in the rest of the lineup was a style choice because supposedly Americans prefer them. Let me know what you think about that down there in the comment section below, because I certainly prefer amber turn signals. Down here at the bottom, we have well-integrated exhaust tips and overall a look that's definitely clean, but definitely in keeping with the rest of the Volvo lineup as well. Down at the bottom of the bumper, we have well-integrated exhaust tips, and overall we have a slightly different look than we see in the XC60, but again, still a member of the Volvo family. As with every other Volvo sold in the United States, the XC40 comes with a 2-liter 4-cylinder engine in every trim, but they're two different power levels. If you get the T4 base model, that gives you front-wheel drive and 184 horsepower. If you want all-wheel drive, then you get this tune of the 2-liter 4-cylinder that produces 248 horsepower. Now, if you're watching this in Europe, you do have a few more options that we don't get in America, including the brand new plug-in hybrid system that is really quite interesting. That gives us about 260 horsepower combined, 178 horsepower from a 3-cylinder turbocharged engine, and the rest from an 80 horsepower electric motor. But that's not the same 80 horsepower electric motor that we see in the other all-wheel drive plug-in Volvos, because the plug-in hybrid XC40 is front-wheel drive only, and that 80 horsepower motor is right here under the hood, not at the rear of the vehicle like we find in the XC60 or XC90 T8. Also different than the T8 plug-in hybrid system, the XC40 PHEV uses a new dual-clutch transmission that we're likely going to see in other Volvo models shortly. A novel design element with the plug-in hybrid system is that the motor is connected directly to one of the input shafts on the transmission, so it can be used to either generate power or power the vehicle forward using one of 3 forward gear ratios, although Volvo tells us that it really is only going to be using one at the moment. That should give us 20 to 30 miles of electric range and significantly better fuel economy than the rest of the XC40 lineup. Unfortunately, Volvo has not said if or when the plug-in hybrid system will come to America. They're being a little bit cagey on that, but I suspect it's probably going to come in the 2021 model year. We should also be seeing full hybrids and mild hybrids available in the XC40 soon, because Volvo has started rolling out their new 48-volt mild hybrids across their lineup in Europe. But in America, at the moment, we just get the T5 all-wheel drive and the T4 front-wheel drive models. As I've come to expect from Volvo, front seat comfort is excellent in the XC40. But although these seats look somewhat like the seats that we see in the XC60, XC90, S60, S90, etc., these are not actually the same seat. This is a new seat design just for the smaller Volvos. The big takeaway here is that we don't find the same kind of adjustability that we find in those larger models, even in the top-end inscription trim, which is what we're driving today. We do have an extending thigh cushion, but it's manual, not powered. It's also not the same shape as we find in the larger Volvos. No inflatable bolsters or anything like that. But we do have a four-way adjustable lumbar support and a tilt telescopic manually adjustable steering column. We have a two-position seat memory over here on the door for the driver, and the power passenger seat has the same range of motion as the driver's seat, but it does lack the memory function. Hopping into the back, we find some of the best headroom and legroom numbers available in this segment, but keep in mind this is a subcompact crossover, so obviously you're going to find more room in something like a BMW X3 or Volvo's own XC60. Still, this is pretty accommodating for me at 6 feet tall. With this front seat adjusted for me, I still have about 3 or 4 inches of legroom left, and if I scoot all the way over to the right side of the vehicle, where this front seat was all the way back in its tracks, my legs are just barely touching the seat back, but he really could have moved that seat a little bit further forward and still have been comfortable. The biggest difference between this and the next category up is going to be rear seat width. So if you want to sit someone in the middle right here, and they're an adult, then everybody needs to be a little bit skinnier than in something like the XC60, because there's just not as much room across the back. Rear seat passengers get a fold-down center armrest. There's a ski pass-through right there in the middle, and this seat back is a 60-40 folding design. If you're a young family thinking about buying an XC40, then you should know that overall legroom in here is not going to be as generous as the next category up, so rear-facing child seats are going to be an awful lot tighter in here than in something like the XC60. So it's definitely one of the big reasons to shop for the next category up is going to be rear child seat placement, especially if you're trying to put it behind an adult up front. Behind the hatch, we find just under 21 cubic feet of storage space. That definitely puts this behind the BMW X1, which has an absolutely enormous cargo area, but this is sort of middle of the pack as far as the competition goes. It's clear that Volvo was definitely prioritizing second row room, because we definitely find more second row room in here than a lot of the competitors, over the cargo area in the back. As we see in other European luxury vehicles, there are definitely a lot of practical cargo touches back here. For instance, this flip and fold load floor. We can put it in this position and then use these little hooks right here for your grocery bags, or you can completely remove it from the vehicle and have access to a slightly deeper storage area. And if we dig even further, we find a compact spare tire right there under the load floor. That's a touch that I really appreciate. Something that I think Volvo could improve on next time, however, is this hard cargo cover. These are a little bit less practical than the roller style, because if you were going to put something large in the XC40 and you wanted to remove this temporarily from the vehicle, you'd have to find somewhere to put this, and it doesn't quite fit under the load floor so easily. You can barely get it to go under there if you really try. There we go. But now you can't put anything under the load floor. The model that we're testing has this large panoramic moonroof that extends to just over the rear passenger's heads. As you can see from this angle, the rear passenger center seat belt comes out of the seat itself. That's definitely something that I prefer. Up front, we get height adjustable shoulder belts for the driver and front passenger. The headrests have the inscription logo embossed in them, and we have a Volvo novelty, which is a headrest that is height adjustable, something that we don't find in the rest of the Volvo lineup. Although admittedly, there are only 3 different stages. This is the highest that the headrest goes, and then that's the lowest right there. As I said before, the overall seat design is a little bit different than the rest of the Volvo lineup in America, but we still have a little Swedish flag right there on the side. The bolstering on the seat back and bottom cushion is not too aggressive, so larger folks shouldn't have any problems with these front seats. And as we move on over to the seat bottom cushion, you can see that we have that thigh cushion extension right there. Again, it's shaped a little bit differently than the rest of the Volvo lineup. As you'd expect in a luxury vehicle, as we move on over to the door panels, we find a higher percentage of soft touch materials and more premium materials than you'd find in the average compact or subcompact crossover in America. Moving to the middle of the dashboard, we do find a few components that are shared with the rest of the Volvo lineup: this touchscreen LCD infotainment system, and then the physical controls below it. This runs essentially the same infotainment software that we see in the XC90 and XC60, and for 2019, this got a much faster processor. So if you've been reading reviews of older Volvo models from 2016 through 2018, where they're complaining about responsiveness of the system, you should know that this software and the processor have been changed. Now, the system is still a little bit slower than some of the competition, but overall, booting up and loading of apps is definitely quicker than it was in the past. But as you can see here, when you're connecting to certain internet services, sometimes the system will be a little bit more sluggish than some of the alternatives out there. Obviously, some of this does have to do with the cell connection and the overall strength of that cell service. But direct functions like accessing climate control screens, things like that, if you want to click on over to the camera view right there, these kinds of things are definitely faster than they were in the pre-2019 Volvos. This also applies to interacting with some of the systems like the autonomous parking system for parking in and out of spaces. Below the infotainment system, again, we find that same button bank that we find in the rest of the Volvo models, except that this button over here is different. This is where we find the drive mode rather than having one of those little roller controls that we see in the rest of the Volvo lineup. Below that, we find a storage area that is always open. There's no lid to cover that off. We find two USB inputs, one that works for smartphone integration, and a 12-volt power port right there. There's also a wireless charging mat in the middle, and a very small storage cubby right here behind that area. Then continuing back from there, we get one of the most divisive features in this cabin, and it is the shifter design. The entire XC40 lineup uses this joystick-style shifter. This is the same one that we find in the T8 versions of the larger Volvos. What seems to be controversial is the way this shifter behaves. So if I want drive, I'm in park right now, I toggle not once, but twice to drive. That's because unlike BMW's iDrive shifter, which has multiple detents, this simply has one click forward, one click backward, and then it returns to center. It's not like the BMW system where there's a click and then another click as you pull further back. That means if you want to go to drive, you double click. If you want to go to reverse from drive, you double click forward, drive again, double click backwards. Some folks out there have said that this seems dangerous somehow. I have to say, I completely disagree with that assessment. Now, I don't find this quite as intuitive to use as the BMW shifter design, but if you were to buy this car after the initial day, you will get completely used to it. And I had absolutely no problem executing three-point turns or anything like that in this car. Double tap back, double tap forward. It's just about as fast as any of the alternative shifter designs, and you do get very, very used to it. I think the big reason that some folks out there have disliked this is because they're reviewers like me, and they're inside different cars every day, and this does stick out as a little bit different than the competition. Be sure and let me know what you think about that down there in the comment section below. Personally, I find this a lot easier to use than any of the push button shifters out there, so let me know what you think about that down there. Some of you might be thinking, what? Is there no manual mode? Yes, there is, and here's how it works. It's back here with the shifter. So again, to engage drive, we double click back from park, and then if we want manual mode, we click once again backwards. We then toggle left for down, and then to the right to change the gear up. Although this is a very clean design overall, it's not indicated right here on the shifter that the shifter has that particular function, and I do think that paddle shifters would make just a little bit more sense. But again, as with the rest of the operations of the shifter, I suspect that most folks out there will get very used to this after they've had the car for a while. Behind the shifter, we have the electric parking brake, the button for the auto brake hold, enable, disable, and then two large cup holders to the right. And then if we go even further back, we have this unusual little garbage can right here. Remember that cup holders are not as big of a deal outside of America, so Volvo is trying to give us different cutesy little features here in the center area. It is removable from the vehicle, so that way you can clean it, and it has a little storage area right there, a little sort of elastic area there to help hold items in there. But if you remove it, the center armrest does not cover that hole, and then that storage area will be completely open to the rest of the cabin. As we see with the rest of the European competition, the XC60's interior was designed to be smaller than, but not less premium than, the larger Volvos. So all XC40 models get this full LCD instrument cluster. Now, I think that's kind of an odd twist because not all of the larger Volvos get this full LCD standard. As you can see, we have a moving map display right there in the middle. It is customizable, but it's not as customizable as the displays that we see in some of the competition. For instance, there are really only four themes, and as I cycle through them here, you'll notice that there's not a huge amount of difference between those four different looks. And in addition to the navigation map, you can see current media right there in the middle, although it is a little bit smaller than some of the competitive displays, or you can choose to see nothing at all. This is also where we find the trip computer readouts. Volvo decided to give the XC40 a unique steering wheel, although it is styled very much like the larger Volvos. We have sport grips up top and a split bottom spoke. There are no paddle shifters on the back, which I think is a little bit of a pity. On the left side, we have the controls for the radar adaptive cruise control. This also works with the pilot assist system. We increase and decrease the distance with those two buttons right over there. And then on the right side of the steering wheel, we have buttons that function as volume, up, down, track, forward, backward, and they work to interact with that menu right there in the LCD instrument cluster. When I first drove the XC40 a number of years ago, one of the things that really impressed me right up front was the overall acceleration in the T5 all-wheel drive. Volvo chose not to derate this engine for use in the XC40, so this produces the same amount of power that we find in the XC90 and in the XC60, but we have a lot less mass to motivate. And that's what helps this model go from 0 to 60 in 6.1 seconds. That is notably faster than something like the Audi Q3. Even the new Q3 is going to be almost a full second slower than this, so is the BMW X1. Now the X2, in regular form, is going to be about 4/10 of a second slower than this, but if you get the new X2 M35i, then it will be significantly faster, but it's also going to be significantly more expensive. The XC40 also does well in our braking test, where it stopped from 60 miles an hour back to zero in 119 feet. Very, very comparable to the rest of the other European options. Of course, the big reality in this segment is that there is no clear winner when it comes to overall handling dynamics anymore, and that's because we no longer have any rear-wheel drive entries in this small crossover segment. BMW's X1 has now gone front-wheel drive. And interestingly enough, the X1, the X2, the Volvo, and the Audi Q3 all use the same 8-speed automatic transmission under the hood. So they all tend to feel very, very similar when it comes to overall acceleration and the way the transmission feels out on the road. Now, when it comes to overall handling dynamics, I think that the BMW X2 does have a very slight lead over this in terms of its overall feel. Part of that has to do with the fact that the Volvo is much higher off the ground. We get about 8.3 inches of ground clearance in here that is significantly higher than the average in this segment. So if you're looking for a Volvo that can go a little bit further off the beaten path than the competition, that would definitely be this model. But that doesn't mean that the Volvo has a softer tuned suspension. This still has a very solid European feel to it overall, and that's why I'm going to give this an A- when it comes to our handling score. This does fall a little bit behind the X2 and of course the new X2 M35i, but this still compares very, very well with the rest of the competition, especially when the competition is comparably priced to the Volvo. The AMG versions of the Mercedes GLA obviously handle well, so does the M235i, and there is a wider tire package available on the Audi Q3 that really will help improve handling. But remember that those models are generally going to cost more than this Volvo. When it comes to our ride score, I'm going to have to give this an A- because very much like the European competition, we have that firmer ride in the XC40 that really helps improve handling, but it is going to reduce the overall ride score, especially if you get this out on a really rough road. That shouldn't surprise you too much, because even though Volvo tends to march to a slightly different drummer than some of the European competition, they still certainly have an eye on overall handling ability. In our cabin noise test at 50 miles an hour, we scored 70 decibels in here, putting this very similar to something like the BMW X1, so I'm going to give this an A when it comes to overall interior cabin noise. If you're looking for something quieter, you may have to get up into the compact category and spend a little bit more money, because there really isn't going to be a subcompact crossover that's significantly quieter than this. Even the Lexus UX Hybrid or the Range Rover Evoque, they're not going to be that much quieter than this. If you want something quieter than the XC40 out on the road, you're probably going to have to move up into the compact luxury category, because even something like the Lexus UX or the Range Rover Evoque, they're not going to be quieter than this. Over a week of mixed driving, we've been averaging 26.4 miles per gallon, which is a pretty decent fuel economy score in this category, and that surprised me a little bit, because Volvo's non-hybrid models generally have been more middle of the road rather than class leading when it comes to fuel economy, but the XC40 is a little bit different than the XC60 and XC90. When we take a look at the competition, this is going to be just about as fuel efficient as a BMW X1 in average driving. Even entries like the Infiniti QX30 with the dual clutch transmission or the Mercedes-Benz GLA can't seem to quite beat this when it comes to overall fuel economy. If you're looking for slightly better economy, then you could move into something like the Lexus UX Hybrid, but you're going to be giving up an awful lot when it comes to overall acceleration and handling ability. The Lexus UX is very, very slow for this category. Your other option, of course, would be to wait and hope that Volvo does bring that plug-in hybrid XC40 to the US. That's likely going to be giving us very similar fuel economy to the Lexus UX with significantly better overall performance. It's gonna have the same amount of power that we find in this model, but it will be a little bit heavier. So I suspect that it may be up to 3/4 of a second slower in the 0-60 time, but that should still put this under 7 seconds 0-60. So notably faster than what we find in the Lexus UX. Bottom lining the XC40 is pretty easy. When it comes to overall handling ability, there is no longer a clear-cut winner in this segment. While the X2 and certain versions of the Q3 will outhandle this model, they're going to cost you more, generally speaking, and the delta is not going to be enormous because in terms of overall driving dynamics, they're very, very similar. Every entry in the segment is now a front-wheel drive vehicle with more weight on the front axle than on the rear axle. So overall driving dynamics are not going to be that far off. The XC40 also gives us an incredible amount of performance for what is the most common engine that you'll be buying in America. Again, comparing this to the BMW and the Mercedes, while there are faster engines available under those hoods, they're going to cost you significantly more than this, and that's not the average one that you're going to find out on the dealer lot. And finally, the XC40 is just easy to live with. It's comfortable, it's quiet, it's spacious on the inside, and even though we do get a little bit more body roll and a little bit vaguer of a steering feel than we find in some of the competition, this is still an awful lot of fun to drive out on the road. It's a little bit more difficult to tell exactly what the front tires are doing in the XC40 versus the BMW X2, but if you were to pit these out on your favorite winding mountain road, you'd find that the X2 really wouldn't be able to pull away from the Volvo unless we're talking about that M235i version. For 2020, the XC40 starts at $34,345. That gets you the base model with the T4 engine and front-wheel drive. The important thing to remember about the XC40 is that if you choose the front-wheel drive model, you only get the T4 engine. If you choose all-wheel drive, then you get the more powerful T5. When looking at the price jump from the front-wheel drive model to the all-wheel drive model, keep that engine change in mind because you do get more power bundled with that all-wheel drive system. Aside from that, all models of the XC40 come very well equipped. Every trim, including the base model, will get a standard 12.3-inch full LCD instrument cluster. That's a pretty unique feature in this segment. Other options offer 12-inch LCD instrument clusters, but nobody else really includes one standard. We also have that 9-inch infotainment system that we saw in the dashboard that is standard, as well as is an XM satellite radio, the smartphone integration, LED headlamps, 4-way adjustable lumbar support, and a power tailgate. Volvo's low-speed auto braking system is also standard, but oddly enough, as I said earlier, their full suite of active safety systems is not standard. You do have to option up into those systems. I think that's really a pity because when we take a look at base trims especially, the Lexus UX comes standard with all of their active safety software, including radar adaptive cruise control, and you have to option the Volvo into some of those systems, and Volvo is theoretically supposed to be the safety leader in this segment. With that out of the way, let's dive right into the competition. I think that the all-new 2020 Audi Q3 is by far the toughest competitor for the XC40. It's brand new, it's very stylish on the outside and on the inside, and as we have seen from Audi in the past, they've priced it very aggressively as well. Now, it is a little bit more expensive than the Volvo at $34,700, but we get more power, 228 horsepower standard in that model, and all-wheel drive is standard as well. If you're simply interested in all-wheel drive, then the Q3 is going to be an incredible deal in its base form, but it is worth noting that it is missing some of the features that we do find in the T5 all-wheel drive base trim of the XC40, and that's really why the price tag is a little bit lower. Once you back out the extra feature content that we find in the Volvo, you'd end up at a relatively comparably equipped vehicle. Inside the Q3's cabin, we find a smaller instrument cluster standard in that base Q3 model. We also have a slightly smaller infotainment system as well. And then there are a few other features that we don't find in that base Q3 model. But feature for feature, dollar for dollar, the Q3 is very, very well matched to the XC40. Now, perhaps the most important thing to know about the Q3 is that at this moment, I have not driven the Q3 yet. Audi, for some reason, did not invite Alex and Autos to the launch event of that particular model, so unfortunately, I can't make any true direct comparisons between it and the XC40. But I have to say that if you're shopping for the XC40 and you're looking out there on the dealer lots and the new 2020 Q3 is finally available in your area, you should definitely give it a long look. It really looks very, very good, and the pricing is very, very attractive as well. I really appreciate the extra style that Audi has tossed into the new Q3's cabin. It may not be to everyone's taste, but I do like the fact that the Q3 is a little bit more adventurously styled than any of the other models in Audi's lineup right at the moment. That takes us along to the BMW X1, a longtime bestseller in this particular segment. This may sound like an insult, but it really is intended as a compliment. The BMW X1 is sort of the Honda Accord of this particular segment. It doesn't necessarily excel in any one specific way, but it does very well across the board. It's a very, very well-rounded vehicle. There may be other models out there that are a little bit quieter, a little bit faster, stop a little bit shorter, handle a little bit better, etc., but the X1 does all of those things above average, and it bundles with it a big cargo area in the back and decent rear seat room as well. Related to the X1 is BMW's X2. It's the more sporty focused version of the subcompact crossover in their lineup, and that model will go faster 0 to 60 than the XC40 that we were driving here if you select the option box for the M35i trim. The M35i can get a little bit expensive if you get carried away with the options, but it's worth noting that something like a Range Rover Evoque or even Cadillac's XT4 can get even more expensive, so that makes the X2 a reasonably good deal if you're after that sportier driving dynamic. It definitely feels a little bit more engaging, but you have to give up the cargo capacity that we find in the X1 in order to get that more sporty demeanor. Speaking of the Evoque, we can't talk about subcompact luxury crossovers without talking about Range Rover's iconic model. The key thing to remember about the Evoque is that it was not necessarily designed as an entry-level model for the Land Rover brand, but for the Range Rover sub-brand, which is definitely a higher-end marquee than most of the other options in this segment. That really shows in the starting price tag. It starts at $46,650, significantly more expensive than any of the other base MSRPs in this segment. We obviously get the high style that we see in all of the other Range Rover models, and like the rest of the Range Rover lineup, we also get a decent amount of customization ability inside the cabin and on the outside. And if you're patient and willing to wait for 2020, there's also going to be a 48-volt mild hybrid system available in that Evoque at some point soon. As you'd expect out of a Land Rover model, off-roading was definitely in mind for the Evoque, but this is certainly the most on-road focused Range Rover model available, so definitely keep that in mind. It's just about as off-road capable as the Volvo XC40. We have very similar overall ground clearance and very similar software programming as well. The terrain management system that we see in the Range Rover is a little bit more advanced. It gives us a little bit more control over exactly what the software is doing, but in general terms, the all-wheel drive system that we find in the Range Rover Evoque operates under the same basic principle as every other entry in this particular group. There are no locking differentials available, no two-speed transfer cases, nothing like that is going on in the Evoque like we do find in the larger and more expensive Range Rover models. But if you're looking for something that is high style and you're willing to pay for it, the Evoque certainly fits that mold. That brings me along to the current bestseller in this segment, the Cadillac XT4. Yes, you heard that right. The Cadillac has dethroned the BMW to be the sales champion in the luxury subcompact crossover group. The sales success of the XT4 has honestly surprised me a little bit, because if you recall the last time I looked at the XT4, I said that I would buy a number of other options over it, mainly based on the XT4's price tag. It starts just under $36,000 and goes all the way on up to about $60,000 if you get carried away with the options. That is significantly more expensive than the BMW, the Audi, the Volvo, the Lexus, any of the other options in this segment. Depending on how you have it configured, the XT4 could even make the Range Rover Evoque look like a pretty decent deal. But that was about 6 months ago, and now that the XT4 has been on sale for a while, we're starting to see the classic Cadillac deals available on the dealer lot, and that really changes the picture for the XT4. I didn't have too much trouble looking at local dealer ads for the Cadillac XT4 near me. About $7,000 to $7,500 off was what I was seeing flashing through most of those ads. It doesn't really seem to be a problem to get at least $5,000 off most trims of the XT4. And when you add that into the picture, then the XT4 makes an awful lot more sense. Because for about $40,000, you could get an XT4 that is either comparably equipped or slightly better equipped than some of the competition. We get a 237 horsepower engine in all models, a 9-speed automatic transmission, and if you choose all-wheel drive, it does have a little bit of a trick up its sleeve. It has a disconnectable clutch mechanism in the rear. It's not quite torque vectoring, but it is definitely along those same lines, and it really makes the XT4 feel a little bit more nimble than some of the other options out on the road, specifically something like a Range Rover Evoque. Now that said, the XT4 still feels a little bit big and a little bit heavy compared to something like the XC40 or the BMW X2, But the X4 ends up being a decent deal. It does have a little bit more cargo capacity than the XC40, but we have to give up a little bit of rear headroom in order to get it. Now, on the other hand, it does have 2 inches more legroom, which may make it a little bit more accommodating depending on the size of your family. When it comes to off-road ability, the XT4 is definitely closer to the ground, so that is something to keep in mind if you do plan on taking your compact crossover a little bit further off the beaten path. That brings me along to the important question of which is the best option in this segment and what would I do if my own money were on the line? Well, at the moment, I have to say that I would still put my own money on the Volvo XC40. The XT4 may be a better deal than it was in the past, but when you comparably equip it to the XC40, the XC40 ends up still being a pretty decent deal. And I like the way the XC40 feels out on the road versus the Cadillac XT4. The XT4 just feels a little bit too big for me. And I have to say that the XC40's overall performance and handling ability is still very impressive. Even though we don't have a 9-speed automatic transmission, and even though we don't have that snazzy all-wheel drive system, the XC40 really still holds its own out on the road. One last thing before we go, I have to say that if I were going to spend my own money in this segment right now, I would probably wait until I could get my hands on the Audi Q3 so I could compare it directly to the XC40 and see which one suited me best. The new Audi Q3 looks really, really good in this particular segment, so I would say if you can, it's definitely worth holding off on your purchase for the moment, waiting until you can get into that Audi Q3 and see which one fits you best. But definitely put the Volvo XC40 on your shopping list. Be sure and let me know down there in the comment section below what you would do if your own money was on the line. If you were looking to spend around $40,000 to $45,000 on a new subcompact crossover, would you get the Volvo, the BMW, the Cadillac, or would you wait for that new Audi Q3? In the meantime, be sure and head over to facebook.com/alexnauto so you can see what I'm driving this week, and I'll see you all later.